So we will start. So dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming to our seminar, Geopolitical Tuesday. I'm very happy to welcome, and I would like to also thank especially Professor Adrien Fauve from the French Institute for Central Asian Studies in Bishkek in Kyrgyzstan, and Joren Santenbosch. Adam Mickiewicz University in Poznan for accepting our invitation. Welcome to University of Warsaw. So I'm very happy to welcome you to the lecture entitled The European Handbook of Central Asian Studies, History, Politics and Societies. This lecture is based on the book co-edited by Joren Santenbosch, Bruno de Cordier and Adrien Fauve. For our audience on the Zoom, please turn off your microphones and cameras. And for your information, this conference is recorded and will be available on the YouTube. My name is Inga Topitska. I'm the research fellow at the French Center for French Culture and Francophone Studies at the University of Warsaw. At the beginning, I will present our guests. After, they will start the lecture, the presentation of their book, and after, we invite you to the session, question and answer. So let me present our guest. Professor Adrien Fauve is a director of French Institute for Central Asian Studies in Bishkek and assistant professor of politics and international relations at Paris-Saclay University. Previously, he was a postdoctoral fellow at CNRS and within Bruno Latour's FORCCAST project on active learning. For 7 years, he has coordinated the Central Asian Seminar Series at CERI-Sciences Po. His research focuses on political sociology and international relations with fieldwork in Central Asia. Thank you for accepting our invitation. And Professor Joren Santenbosch studied area studies and political science at the Catholic University in Leuven, in Belgium, before obtaining his PhD at Adam Mickiewicz University in Poznan. On the topic of personalist rule in sub-Saharan Africa, recently published and turned into a book. He continues to study authoritarian ecosystems as an independent scholar and works at Adam Mickiewicz University as a project coordinator. Currently, he coordinates several Erasmus strategic partnerships. His research fields encompass theories of dictatorships, their classification, autocratic cooperation, democratization, political regimes theories, bribing international relations, and dictatorship research. With his background in sub-Saharan Africa and Central Asia, he's currently branching out to make comparisons to other world regions. Thank you for accepting our invitation. Today, Adrien Fauve and Joren Santenbosch will present the recent book co-edited with Bruno de Cordier entitled The European Handbook of Central Asian Studies, History, Politics and Societies. This handbook is the first collection of comprehensive teaching materials for teachers and for students also of Central Asian Studies with a strong pedagogic dimension. It presents 22 chapters clustered around 5 themes with contributors from more than 19 scholars, leading experts in the field of Central Asian studies and Eurasian studies. This collection is not only a reference work for scholars branching out to different disciplines of Central Asian studies, but also for scholars from other disciplines, broadening their scope to Central Asian studies. It addresses post-colonial frameworks and also unpacks topics from their Soviet reference frame. So after the lecture, we invite you to question and answer session. You could write your comments and questions on the chat. And now I invite Adrien Fauve and Joren Santenbosch. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Adrien, do you want to start?
Yes, I will try to start, even if my internet connection is quite low. So, first of all, great thank you to Dr. Kinga Torbitska for inviting us to this presentation. Thank you to Centre des Cultures Francouzes et Studios Francophones at the University of Warsaw. I'm really happy that we can present today, introduce to the audience one of the major results of this project, which was coordinated by my colleague Jeroen van den Bos, and who actually invited me together with Bruno de Cordier to participate. So I'm very happy that as co-authors, we can make this presentation and connect with you. So thank you very much to the organizers. I think what is important in this 21st century, and especially after the pandemic, that we continue working as networks, expanding our networks, where as a scientific community, reach out to the audience. So this is something I would like to stress. The handbook is the main result of this project, but also we organized, thanks to the efforts of Bruno de Cordier and Jeroen van den Bos, a major conference in Ghent several weeks ago. It was our first post-COVID event, which was successful. The people were so happy to meet again. And we also met so many new people working on the region. And in the framework of these Geopolitical Tuesdays, we are very grateful that you expressed interests towards our handbook. This handbook is the result of a more than 3 years work in the thanks to Erasmus Plus strategic partnership. I'm sure Jeroen will explain probably the details and the general dynamics of this project. So basically, the handbook was possible because of 11 partner institutions which were very much involved in this work. And so many authors, I counted 22, coming from almost a dozen of countries, mostly European countries, but we have colleagues who were also, of course, in Central Asia and the US. And some of our colleagues are actually co-affiliated to Japanese institutions. And this network is really huge. And as this is a Geopolitical Tuesday, of course, we are valorizing, promoting the handbook to those who would like to write essays, master thesis or doctoral thesis articles on Central Asia or about connections between Europe and Central Asia, but also to people who teach geopolitics or Central Asian studies or Eurasian studies. We are very grateful to the organizers to give us the opportunity to promote this teaching material, which we have been working on. Basically, the project lasted more than 3 years. Maybe Jeroen will elaborate on that, but because of COVID, we were a little late, and also we were granted with some additional months. So this will all resume by the end of December this year. As this is a Geopolitical Tuesday, I would like to come back to some of the elements that are explained in one of the introductions to the handbook. As reminded by Jeroen van den Bos in the chat, you can download it for free. It's an open access one. Can you imagine more than 1,000 pages for free with exercises after each chapter, with YouTube lectures in parallel of chapters and so on? I would like to come back to some of the reasons why people might be interested in studying Central Asia. So, of course, it's a region which is located at the crossroads of many cultural worlds. So there are several strata which are actually all concentrated in this region, and many influences actually coexist. Mongolian, Turkic, Iranian, Russian, Chinese influences are all concentrated in this region, and it is so complicated. This is why what makes Central Asia interesting and appealing. So I would like to stress this first point. And it's also a region where sedentary and nomadic populations were in very active contact, sometimes at war, sometimes at peaceful interactions. And all these aspects that I just outlined are explained in the first part after the introductions. There are three introductions because we had many things to explain about the handbook. From chapter 4 to 8, all these aspects about why studying Central Asia and all these historical interests and legacies are explained in chapters from 4 to 8. Then another section of the handbook is devoted to the many complexities of social reality, of all these cultural influences, identities and religions, languages, which were very much affected by this process of Sovietization, 70 years under this very specific regime in the history of humankind. And these legacies now, they cope with something which is new, like which makes our time very different from the 20th century, which is globalization and the assertion of national identities, these nation states, which continue asserting and constructing. And of course, the entanglement between economic and political and social interest groups. So all these aspects, which are very much in connection with the consolidation of authoritarian regimes, all these are tackled in the section from chapter 9 to 14. By the way, you will find chapter by Jeroen van den Bos and another one by me on very much political aspects, so regimes and elections. Now, if we turn to the more macro-regional and international perspectives, geopolitics of Central Asia, well, we try to stress the reason why it's interesting for people who specialize broadly in world politics, not only who have a focus on Central Asia, but why Central Asia should be interesting to anyone. So this is something which was important to us to stress. So all these rivalries between major powers, middle powers, local countries, well, as Alexander Cooley puts it in his major book, Great Games, Local Rules, of course, we have to be interested by all these influences from China, Russia, the European Union, the US, India, Pakistan, Japan, South Korea, and so on, Turkey, in the region. But also, we have to be interested by the agency of Central Asian elites, political elites, economic elites, cultural elites on the world arena. So we try to map this and also Central Asia now, because of the situation in Afghanistan, again, becomes interesting to the world audience. And probably Jeroen might want also to tackle the problematic definition, the many definitions of Central Asia, which was also a matter of interest. So all these aspects, which I think to our audience today are interesting, are tackled in chapters 15 to 18. Now about things concerning more the economy and the environment, we also have chapters about resources and energy, water management, and so on, and migration trends in connection with Russia, but not only. This is very important. And political economy and all these development legacies, which come from Soviet times and now were completely also modified by external aid and all these projects from various institutions, organizations, and so on. So these are more tackled in chapters from 19 to 22. So, and also in this introduction that I am more or less reading, but not exactly quoting, I'm trying to just get the spirit. There is another reason which seems important to us, because we try to promote the interests of our own academic community, is that one of the reasons why people must be interested in Central Asian studies is that there are hundreds of people in the world today who specialize in the study of this region. So this makes it of social importance, significance, right? If people devote their academic, intellectual, personal life to understand this region and all the things that I just mentioned previously, well, this stresses the importance. And another aspect is that in parallel to our handbook project, there are two other major volumes, collective volumes, who were just published or are about to be launched in the world. So there is one under the editorship of Rico Isaacs and Erika Marat, who just was launched almost the very same day than ours, and another one by David Montgomery. So this year, three major handbooks or collective volumes or whatever the word you choose to name them in English for this kind of audience of people who specialize on studying the region, on for people who teach about the region and so on. They were, you know, published at this in the same year. So this shows also the importance of this region on the geopolitical arena and in academic circles, if not in expert also circles. So these major handbooks, the very fact that they appear at the same moment, I think it underlines, it stresses the geopolitical importance of the region. And also, maybe I don't want to be too long because first of all, I want to leave some space to Jeroen, who has, I'm sure, many things to tell you. And also, I think we need to be concise because there's going to be a Q&A session and I'm not sure my connection will be steady because I'm here from Central Asia talking to you. I would like to remind some historical dates which are important for the study of the region. So in the 80s, in 1985, a specific club of people who specialized on the study of the region appeared. It's called the European Society for Central Asian Studies, ESCAS, which now regroups hundreds of academics and organizes international conference. Last time we were with Jeroen and other members of the team in Exeter, I think it was 2019. ESCAS organized 16 international conferences since the mid-90s, basically every 2 years, sometimes in the region in Central Asia, sometimes in Europe and even in Turkey. Well, this is one thing I wanted to stress, and being myself a member of this European Society for Central Asian Studies, I think it's important to stress the existence. I will not read all these mapping we did about the main institutions, institutions, universities, research centers in Europe who specialize on the region. You will find this in one of the introductions. But there is another point I would like to stress. For those who are not aware, there are devoted journals, Central Asian Survey, Central Asian Affairs, and then you can enlarge and say, talk about Europe-Asia studies and other kind of journals. There is one in French, which is coordinated from the institution I am working with today, which is called Cahiers d'Asie Centrale, Centralne Asiatskie Tetradie in Russian, which publishes articles in French, English, and Russian. Also, it exists since the mid-90s. And now, a final point. about how Central Asian studies as a field is experiencing an evolution, which is major in our view. And I think Jeroen agrees with me because we discussed this recently in Ghent, and I think we have a common position on that. Central Asian studies were divided in the 80s and 90s between people who were living there, Central Asians, who were doing research in the social sciences, in the humanities, and so on, archaeologists, historians, geographers, anthropologists, political scientists, and so on, who were publishing mostly in Russian, okay, who were trained in the Soviet way, and then in the 90s, in the very like immediate post-Soviet way. And then on the other hand, there were Western or just foreign experts from Europe, from Northern America, from Japan, India, mostly, or Turkey sometimes, mostly. But now things are much more different. And so I would like to submit to the audience this idea that there are at least three profiles of scholars now, because there are Central Asians who did their PhDs abroad and who came back to the region. There are people from abroad who live and work and teach in the region. There are Central Asians who left forever and now are somewhere else, but still continue publishing. So this makes the picture much more complex. So I would like to stress that. First of all, there are local scholars, people who work in Central Asia and who are either originating from the region, okay, they are locals, or there might be foreigners who have a significant experience of living there, knowing the languages, have immediate access to knowledge on the ground and so on. As sometimes they are there almost for 20 years. I mean, this is very serious. Second, native scholars, people who obviously were born and raised in Central Asia, but sometimes have been trained abroad and might also be affiliated nowadays with institutions in Europe, in the US, in the Gulf. Very much, there are a lot of attractive universities for people who do Central Asian studies, who were born in the region and have foreign PhDs. And the Asia Pacific, Singapore, Hong Kong, even Japan, South Korea. So people who were born in Central Asia, but live somewhere else and do Central Asian studies. And finally, foreign scholars, people who come and go, who were born outside of Central Asia, let's say in Europe, went there for fieldwork or visits, and now make themselves a career outside of Central Asia. Also, so this is very complex, local scholars, native scholars, foreign scholars. Of course, this is disputable, this typology. Our common friend and colleague, Bruno de Cordier, considers there are also semi-natives, people who come from the post-communist world, let's say from Bulgaria, or from the Baltic states, and can understand something which is about this Russo-Soviet legacy with which societies now are coping. So this is another argument. At least there are like three or four profiles, which is very different from what we knew at least 20 years ago. I think I will stop there. Thank you again for inviting us. Once again, this is so pleasant when you have almost finished a project, you have true results, a handbook, a conference, a network. And I do hope we are actually being useful to global academia, to Central Asian studies, and to the study of geopolitics. Thank you again. Looking forward to your questions. And I'm leaving the floor to the next one.
Thank you, Adrien. So, Joran, the show is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. I hope everybody can hear me well. So, I can give you the history of the project and so on, and where it came from, but in all its meticulous details, but I don't think that is very interesting like the project origins and so on. So I'll mostly highlight some of the aspects that were the driver behind the design of the project. I will leave the ins and outs of how the project was established. I will just keep it anecdotal. And actually highlight maybe some aspects that you guys will care more about. So I don't know how many of you are really familiar with Central Asia as a region. If not, then I really recommend our handbook as a sort of initiation to get into the region, to get to know it. I am self-taught in the sense that I had a background in Slavonic studies, but not in Central Asian studies or Eurasian studies per se. And I kind of migrated myself into this field after going to leaving Belgium to Poznan in 2010, that was. So I started working in Central Asia. I started reading my first histories, gathering and then creating a course. And creating a course to teach about a subject you're a little bit uncertain about is the best way to get into the topic, because you're standing in front of a classroom, students have questions, and you have to be able to answer those, right? And this is where I noticed that it was very hard to find suitable didactic materials. What was out there was either very basic, like Wikipedia basic, just like facts about Central Asia. These are the five post-Soviet Central Asian countries. These are the capitals. So many people live there. And like these kind of facts. There were a lot of histories out there, which are hundreds and hundreds of pages and very detailed. And they never really cover the full period from ancient times and modern times. So the modern times, especially after independence, they're kind of glossed over. Then you have political science histories, political histories of modern times, but those are very much focused on a couple of topics like terrorism and the insecurity in Afghanistan and the independence, but not so much afterwards. So a lot was written about the transition from the independence of Central Asian states as full independent nations in the international system, but then not so much in how these countries evolved, because from an outsider perspective, like a state-centric perspective, all these states have been quite static. Maybe except for, I would say, Kyrgyzstan, which has many political upheaval and turnover, and also Tajikistan because it had a civil war. But all the other countries are kind of like looked at as stable, even if a lot of changes do happen there, but you have to open the black box of the state and look inside. So there was not much out there, and there was definitely nothing cross-disciplinary that would touch elements of anthropology, which are necessary, and elements of sociology, history, political science. But this is in general where this the idea of where this handbook came from. It's because I was missing something like that myself when I was teaching, that I thought it would be a great idea to actually create that. And I was not the only one that actually came to this idea. So as Adrien already mentioned, Erika Marat and Rico Isaacs, and also David Montgomery, they also actually felt the same vacuum, but they all filled this vacuum in a different way. And this is where our handbooks also differ. We really focused to have a handbook that is a didactic material for teachers and for students, both in classroom setting and for self-study, while David Montgomery's work that's going to come out is mostly for professionals working in and with the region that need very concise but detailed information about certain dimensions of the region. So say that you're working in humanitarian aid and you're going to Kyrgyzstan, you will be located there to work for a couple of years, and you need to know something about how civil society functions and so on, then this is the go-to handbook for professionals to quickly update the basic information that they need. But the chapters are very short because it's people that are working professionally don't always have the time to read hundreds and hundreds of pages if they need very concrete information. Our handbook, we didn't go that way. Our chapters are quite long, so actually we introduced more topics. We also covered some of the basic concepts and also take the time to explain them, either in the text if it's directly relevant or by adding info boxes so they can be optional for readers. And then we have all these other elements like glossaries and so on. And then the handbook by the Routledge handbook by Marat and Isaacs. This one is really another effort, a very much needed effort, to get Central Asian voices into the English mainstream. So this is more like cutting edge research. It's for the target group are established Central Asian scholars, mostly political scientists. And the idea of this is like giving a run through in where, in what directions new research is going, and have some local perspectives, native perspectives, as Adrien would call it, on the current state of the disciplines and so on. But this were a handbook difference. So we fully opted for the didactic dimension, and this also has to do with the nature of the project. And this is where I will highlight a couple elements of the project. The most important thing is that the handbook has been created. We've also come up with some curriculum design recommendations soon, mostly for institutions that want to create Central Asian studies or update Central Asian studies, make it a little bit more coherent with the labor market needs, at least at the European level, and also recommendations in how to cover some black holes and pitfalls that kind of sneak in when Central Asian studies are framed. So what was the idea of the project? Well, the idea of the project was the following. So it's called Eurasian Insights, Strengthening Central Asian Studies in Europe, with the abbreviation AISCAS, which is very similar to ESCAS, which is the one that Adrien already mentioned, European Society of Central Asian Studies, which is a sort of international organization, informal organization that brings scholars and students together. This one was just the name of a European project. It is an Erasmus Plus project, a strategic partnership from the, I think it was the 2016 to 2020, 2014 to 2020. It was this batch, this kind of grant scheme. And this was an educational project in higher education. So it had to be directed at university levels, bachelor, master, PhD level. And it has to have a didactic dimension, either by creating didactic tools, in this case, the handbook, and also the online videos, which you also will find on our YouTube channel, and which are also integrated in the handbook by links and QR code. And then some guidelines for institutions also to strengthen these didactic dimensions in order, and that's the main aim, to make Central Asian studies in Europe, at least that was the scope of it. Europe, others outside of Europe will also benefit from it, but the focus was European because of the European funding, of course, to make it a little bit more resilient, because this is where we actually get to the issue of the problem. We have very few Central Asian scholars. We have a lot of them globally if you all bring them together, but at every institution we mostly have 1, 2, 3. Not often we have a huge department full where we have like 50 Central Asian. That doesn't happen. Central Asian scholars are too far and few, few and far in between when it comes to filling academic positions. And this also brings a certain unbalanced unstable coherence, in the sense that Central Asian scholars travel a lot from institution to institution while they're establishing themselves and consolidating an academic position. It also means that the teaching only starts and is stable when you have established professors that will not change institution anymore, and then can create a sort of critical mass in order to create a specialization of Central Asian studies. And many of these courses pop up and then disappear when the necessary staff moves on or finds new job opportunities. And this gives a lot of instability for potential Central Asian students who are, they are left with a specialization and a tradition of research that is left at their institution. But since it's mostly based on one or two persons, it's usually very fragmented and selective. And I don't say this in a bad way. It's just discipline bound, in the sense that if you have an anthropologist, which is a Central Asian scholar, and he or she creates a course on this topic, it will be biased towards anthropology. And this is where the problem of Central Asian study is. In order to become a good Central Asian scholar, you cannot stick only to your subdiscipline or major discipline. So it cannot only be anthropology, it cannot only be history, it cannot only be political science, it cannot only be sociology or archaeology or linguistics. The region is so complex and so interacts on so many levels that all these disciplines are necessary. And this is where it's in Central Asia is definitely the poster child of a real area studies in which all these disciplines to some degree should communicate with one another in order to create a more all-round study program. And this is what we try to do in the handbook, and it's focused on the three major disciplines, which is history, political science, and then anthropology and sociology, together. But of course, we have topics that branch out and link. So we have about environmental politics, we have a chapter on law in Central Asia. And so we also branch out to different elements. Many aspects of archaeology are also very important, and these results are also shown in chapters in history. So like this interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary aspect is key to understanding Central Asia. And because Central Asia is not only fragmented according to different disciplines and not enough critical mass is available at European universities and also outside Europe, same in Australia and other Western universities, even in Russia, it's kind of fragmented between different units across the country. There are other also cleavages, and this is of course the division between those who have easy access to the English mainstream, those who keep publishing in their local language and their local culture, like Polish Central Asian Studies, both at Warsaw, at Poznan University, like Adam Mickiewicz University here in Poznan. There are scholars working, established scholars working in Central Asia, but they publish a little bit in English and the rest they publish in Poland, and most of their insights never really get to the mainstream literature or only in a derived version when they turn their major research into an article here and there. So these scholars mostly connect, but there's also a huge amount of scholars that keep publishing in their own language. And it's the same for Germany or for France and Italy. So this is also the aspect. And here also many Central Asian scholars kind of fall out of the boat. They might have excellent access to the fields through interviews, to connecting with research subjects, research objects, places, localities. Of course, there's always elements of positionality. Can they really separate themselves from the aspects that they're researching if they are part of the same culture? Do they always see enough? Are they critical? What the elements are biased? But this is true for every scholar and his or her position towards what they're researching. So Central Asian scholars are not necessarily worse in this regard, but their access and their knowledge of languages and understanding of culture and access to sources, archives, interviews is so valuable. But most of their research is either published in Russian, also to a lesser degree in national languages, and also doesn't really articulate back into the mainstream. And this is where we are the loss. And this is what Erika Marak and Erika Isaacs also wanted to amend a little bit. And to a certain degree, also David Montgomery in his edited volume, is to get more Central Asian voices into it. Our European project funding made this very difficult. Of course, we have we use a lot of work of Central Asian scholars that we have consulted when writing our chapters. But the Central Asian scholars from the region involved in our project are, of course, those that have been affiliated with Western institutions or European institutions for years. In this regard, they're a little bit in between. They're both native and, of course, part of the European mainstream on Central Asia. And this makes Central Asia both fascinating but also very difficult to get into as a newcomer. So for students, it's very challenging. And this also has to do with the definition of Central Asia. And I can expand on this a little bit, but I would just advise you all to actually just read the first and the second chapter in this regard of the handbook. The second one was co-authored by me and Bruno Cordier. And here, for instance, we define the essence of Central Asia as an object of study, as Central Asia is a modern construct So it's a concept invented in the 19th century, a little bit earlier, 19th century, to denote a much older civilization that no longer exists. And here you have the whole range of problems. So you have the name and the borders of what constitutes Central Asia. Are we talking about post-Soviet Central Asia? Are we talking about Central Asia that also includes northern Iran, northern Afghanistan, the eastern provinces of China, southern Siberia? So which is the Central Asia we're talking about? They have many geopolitical definitions that are, of course, motivated by geopolitical agendas that have a stake at defining something this way and not that way, putting a country in a certain concept or leaving it out for reasons of funding, security, focus, priority. And we have many competing ones. We have Greater Central Asia, we have Greater Central Asia, we have the Greater Middle East, we have there is the also ancient concept. This is very well explained in the chapter by Slavomir Horak from Charles University, who wrote about geopolitics. His chapter was, I'll tell you, it is chapter number 15. So the history and evolution of geopolitics of our Central Asia. This might be in particular interest for this group. So we have all these competing stakes, right? And that is the thing. Where do we draw the boundaries of Central Asia? And in the chapter with Bruno Cordier, we actually didn't want to say this is how you should define Central Asia and this is why you should stick to it. We made our own choice in order to have consistency throughout the chapters, but we actually highlight the use and the pitfalls of three main approaches. The Central Eurasia approach, which is the most widest approach possible to focus on Central Asia. The Central Asia plus, in the sense of the Central Asia as where the old civilization that really typically defined Central Asia ended, but the boundaries and borders of current countries and states do not really overlap anymore so neatly. And then the Central Asia post-Soviet definition, so comprising of the five Central Asian states, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, and Uzbekistan, of course, leaving Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iran, and all the others out. And this definition is also very important in order to focus on how Central Asia has changed, because the Soviet, the Tsarist colonial conquest, and then the Soviet occupation and transformation really set this part of the older Central Asian civilization miles and miles apart what used to be. And this is, of course, the transition, the transformation, which is very relevant today when highlighting and researching contemporary Central Asia. And this makes it so difficult in Central Asia. So we have different definitions, we have different ways of highlighting borders, and then different names. Where do these names come from? How did Central Asian call their own regions? How did they see themselves identity-wise? Which different names exist for Central Asia to denote a region more or less in the past, Inner Asia, High Asia. So all these things are also explained. We have a case study that actually highlights all the proper names for Central Asia and the exonyms in detail over time. So these are very useful texts for students, and not only students, also scholars that want to migrate into the Central Asia and they have expertise in, say, the Caucasus of Russia or even Central or Eastern Europe, and they want to move in and make some more comparisons or comparative research to Central Asia. Well, they will find this handbook very handy because it takes the time to explain these things, these major topics, from the beginning, with enough context and with footnotes, info boxes. Also, we created a whole set of original maps for the handbook that I'm very proud of, and they really are. We create them together with authors, and they really make it very accessible to for students also to visualize different aspects and the relevant topics from chapters on different maps, depending, and the focus depends on the topic, of course. So That is maybe not a nutshell, because I'm talking for a while already, the whole idea behind that. So what do we hope to achieve now when this handbook comes out? We hope that actually teachers will use it. So if a teacher is an expert in anthropology, history, and so on, and wants to create a new course or update his or her course on Central Asia, this person can use the handbook and also the online lectures on political science, on history, on other topics that he or she is less familiar with, in order to enrich his or her course. So that is actually the main goal. And that is why it was so important for us to make this handbook available in open access. So students will not have to pay 100 euros to actually have access to these teaching materials, to these didactic materials. We succeeded in this. The handbook is actually completely free. I passed on the link earlier. Download it. Pass it on to anybody that you know that is working on it. And for teachers also, we went a little bit further. So actually highlighted also different exercises. There, for teachers and also for students interested in self-study, I very much recommend also chapter number 3, which is written by our didactic expert, Justina Harash, and together with me. And this also highlights the didactic vision in detail in how the handbook can be used for both for teaching and classroom dynamics, but also for self-study and for how to approach the study, how to use the questions, how to use the exercises, how to think about the assignments, and also how to interact with the online lectures, which do not really fully replace the content in the chapters, because they were created in parallel, but the chapters evolved a little bit onwards after the lectures were recorded. So we offered a lot of materials. Also, we have other stuff. We have an index that highlights, according to 4 different dimensions, all the relevant topics. We have a glossary of over 150 core concepts related to the discipline, to the different disciplines covering and working on Central Asia studies. We have many theoretical excursions. We have extra case studies. So we really try to put a lot into this book in order to make it kind of Swedish buffet for students and teachers that actually want to read a couple of chapters that are relevant for them. So it's the tool for syntopical reading. So we want every student, every teacher to take the handbook, look at the chapters and the titles, or go to one of the last pages and look at the list of learning outcomes and what can I get from each chapter, and make a decision, what will I read and how this is going to benefit me for my writing project, for my class that I have to prepare, for my essay, for my master paper, and so on. So I think I will stop here, and if you have any more questions, I'm very delighted to answer anything you throw at me in the question and answer session. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Adrien Fauve and Fontaine Bosch, for presenting us your book and for presenting us the region of Central Asia. And we invite you, of course, to download the book from the link which I already sent it to. And now, if you have a question or comment, we invite you to ask in the room or on the chat on the Zoom also. Yes, if maybe you can come here closer to the microphone and ask the question, please.
I'm really sorry, the microphone is here, but I think that if you're going to talk, you're here for.
Yes.
I'm actually not an expert in political science, because I study at the Faculty of Economics, but actually the topic is of my interest. But I just have I just want to know, for instance, like how homogeneous is the region? And if in the book, are you focusing on just certain country, or you are covering like the entire region? Like, are you specifying like the differences between like some countries? Because I mean, I assume that most of them might have like some links with the Soviet Union, but Maybe like there might be some specificities within some countries, maybe some might be more like economically advanced than the others. I just want to know like how the region is like organized, like if there's like a certain homogeneity within the region.
Thank you.
So.
Okay, thank you for your question. Adrien, do you want to take this one?
Well, we can take it both. I will be short, and probably if you want, I'm sure you will, with your brilliant mind, you will add so many things. It's not so homogeneous in terms of geography, because on the one hand, you have mountains, and the other hand, plains, either deserts, steppes, or oases around rivers, basically, and some big lakes, such as the Balkhash, the Issyk-Kul, the Aral Sea, which is not so big now, and the Caspian Sea. So I think it's not so homogeneous in geographical terms. Then there is the linguistic aspect that you have among the five post-Soviet Central Asian countries. So we are now talking about Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, right? Mostly. Even if some of the chapters tackle Xinjiang, Afghanistan a little bit, but still, this is the core region that we are studying. Basically, there are four Turkic-speaking countries, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and Kyrgyzstan, whereas there is one Persian-speaking Persianophone, which is Tajikistan. So this is a major difference, even if all these countries were Sovietized, were Russified at some point, with contrasts, because today Russian has a specific status or is recognized in constitutions, but in countries such as Uzbekistan and Tajikistan, even the economic elite is using less and less Russian as a language of communication, apart from those who do business with other countries in the region and Russia or post-Soviet countries within the framework, for instance, of the Eurasian Economic Union, which is composed of five post-Soviet countries. So there is already, you see, a contrast. And if you're thinking about one of the major features of the cultural history of the region, is that there are populations who historically were more sedentary, let's say in Uzbekistan and Tajikistan, and other populations which were more nomadic, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, even if, of course, urbanization and Soviet modernization and Russo-Soviet, because the Tsarist period also changed many things. This absolutely changed. There were also forced migrations and so on. So, but basically, sedentary and nomadic, legacies, these are some of the contrasts. Plus, in economic terms, they are quite rich countries in terms of GDP and their soil, which is basically Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan, which are the richest. And Kazakhstan being really the top one in this regard, whereas very poor countries such as Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, in comparison, much more dependent from Chinese also finances, because respectively Kyrgyzstan has 35% of its budget financial debt, which is held by the PRC, and Tajikistan even more, probably 42% of its financial debt held by Chinese, I mean People's Republic of China. So these are major differences. And in terms of international relations, two countries which are members of the Eurasian Economic Union, driven by Russia, which is Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, whereas the other three are not. And then finally, Turkmenistan, which has, in terms of foreign policy, a very neutral positioning, participating to as less as possible multilateral organizations and regional organizations. So these are a lot of contrasts that I can outline, basically. And I think I will stop, because I'm sure Jeroen has so many things to say also.
Thank you, Adrien. Yes, when it comes to the region is very diverse, as Adrien mentioned, but we did opt not to have different chapters per country, because you lose the comparative advantage. And this is actually where the juices, where the insights come, is in order to compare all five former Soviet countries in their diversity. And separating them each in one chapter would be great for like a reference book with economical data and so on. And these have existed in the 90s and the 2000s, but these books are now outdated. And they're also not that accessible, because if you really want to understand the region, you look for the contrasts and the comparisons and the parallels. And this is what we do topic by topic by topic. So every chapter, the historical ones less, they still focus on the mountainous areas and the highland and the lowland Central Asia and the different social, economic and cultural systems that developed around their environments and how they interacted and how they shifted over time. So they look at different historical divergences, but each chapter focusing on modern times, they do focus on the differences between power, economic possibilities and potential, the differences in authoritarian contexts, which are also very significant, different migration patterns, different urbanization patterns, different industrialization patterns. So every chapter highlights the differences between these five countries. And we paid extra attention when framing the handbook that to also highlight some understudied aspects or understudied countries in certain dimensions. So I think we did, with the authors, we did a pretty good job in actually giving a full coverage of all five countries in their complexity. But which dimensions matter for what depends on the topic. And that's why the handbook is topically structured according to 23 introductory chapters and then 19 different topics. So I hope that answers your question. But but also, and this is also the one of the, this makes the threshold into studying Central Asia so difficult is, yeah, in the media, this whole region is treated as one big whole. But you have to open the black box of the region to actually look at this. It's the same as people say that Africa is a continent, and they treat Africa as a country, actually. So like there's only one Africa without the divergences between South and Central, East, West, the Horn, the North, the Maghreb. So all these different regions, and Africa, of course, is much more, has much more variation, it's much bigger. But Central Asia is not small. They're about the size, it's larger than Western Europe, so it also has a lot of variation for a region. This and a very long tradition also. So I will stop here. If there's any more questions, I'm looking forward to hear them or read them. Mm-hmm.
Yes, we have one question on the chat from Mateusz Kępa. How are the relations between the post-Soviet Central Asian states? Is it close to the cooperation between the Baltic states or the conflict we see in the
Caucasus? Yeah. You want to go first, Adrien?
No, I let you go first. We can change the order.
Okay, we can do that. Because we're both political scientists, Adrien and I, so for these are the good questions for us. So it's always like a little tug of war, who's going to deal with this one. Relations between Central Asian states now are civilized, more or less. I highlight this also in one of my info boxes in the chapter that I co-authored with Bruno de Cordier is, can we consider this area a region or not? And then not a region in, can we witness regional integration like common institutions and so on? Not so much. There have been a couple of international collaboration projects that ended up in somewhat functioning international organizations, but there's only one or two. And they have actually not been that effective. But the tensions between the Central Asians, Central Asian states that were there and were really there after independence, these have mitigated somewhat. And the main reason for this is a sort of locking in the autocratic stability by China and Russia and also Western players that need to cooperate with Central Asian regimes in order to for their own geopolitical reasons, mostly in order to deal with the insecurity in Afghanistan. They support autocracy and stability in Central Asia. And this support for stability in order to deal with a larger threat in at the southern fringes of Central Asia proper, so Afghanistan, has stabilized also the tensions. Also, the first generation of leaders that had personal conflicts, like Karimov and Nazarbayev, Karimov with almost everybody, but also between Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, these have given not a clean slate after the death of Karimov in 2016, but also, they gave an opportunity for autocratic modernization and resetting relations, because these antagonistic international relations didn't really benefit anybody. They were necessary for international, for legitimacy for the people, to show that a leader is strong and is not bending towards its weaker neighbors. In generally, conflicts have abated a little bit. They still exist at local level, and those conflicts mostly come out of socioeconomic grievances, like we saw with the border clashes between Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan last summer, was it? Or last spring? There is a will of leaders at state level not to have these kind of conflicts escalate, and also not using them for geopolitical games, because they don't know how it escalates and so on. The less conflict they have between them at the borders, the more their regimes benefit, and it's easier to stay into power this way. Also have to keep in mind that all regimes in Central Asia are autocratic. And this way, there's also no conflict that one country is trying to push democracy on another country. So there's also no ideological conflict between them as such. Adrien?
Yes, absolutely. If we look at three ways to be in interaction, cooperation, competition, and conflict, I think there is a lot of cooperation, not always in a framework of the five countries of the region. Sometimes it's in the framework of regional organizations or broader organizations, such as the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the Eurasian Economic Union, the CSTO, the Russia-driven security and defense cooperation agreement. I'm sorry, I cannot remember the exact acronym, what it means in English. There are various ways to cooperate, also within the CIS, even if it's not so active, and so on. So this is, on the one hand, cooperation, sometimes driven by major powers, there is bilateral cooperation, and investment. For instance, Kazakhstani capital, money is invested in Kyrgyzstan, in real estate, especially around the Issyk-Kul Lake, which attracts so many tourists in the summer. There are investments and so on. And there is an expert community of people who do IR, work in think tanks, who organize conferences together in the region and so on. So this really exists. And in early August, there was a consultative meeting of the five heads of states for the third time in history in Ashgabat, Turkmenistan, early August 2021, in the format of just the five countries. Plus, they sometimes participate to meetings with the EU, because there is a European strategy for Central Asia, with the US, it's called the 5+1 kind of meetings, and so on. So this is for cooperation. And I think regionalism is a huge question So the five post-Central Asian countries, post-Soviet Central Asian countries, do not really cooperate in a formal way apart from these consultative meetings, only third time in 30 years. Then competition. The two main economic drivers of the region, Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan, in the 90s and early 2000s, did compete for leadership in the region, attracting foreign investment, being active on the world stage, then after 9/11, negotiating with the US and the coalition who would host bases for operations in Afghanistan and so on. And now also, you know, negotiating a relationship with Russia. So these are competing, even if in economic terms, now Kazakhstan is way ahead. And for its also integration in multilateral organizations also. But still, because, of course, my viewpoint is a bit biased because I specialize on Kazakhstani politics and international relations. And the very fact that Kazakhstan was a non-permanent member of the UN Security Council in 2017-18, which was the first of the region to be so, and also the first country, post-Soviet country, to hold the presidency of OSCE in 2010, was also quite a strategic move. But anyways, there is competition. This is important to notice, even between Tajikistan and Uzbekistan, when you think of just bilateral relation with France, because today I'm working a lot with French diplomats in the region. Well, yes, the very fact that the Tajik president Rahmon was hosted in 2019 by Emmanuel Macron in Paris, whereas it hasn't happened for a while with the Uzbek president. This is also a matter you know, of competition. There's going to be a huge exhibition opening this week in France about the cultural legacy of Tajikistan. So they are like cultural rivalries. Then conflict. Yeroun stressed the fact that there are border tensions. There was a conflict, a deadly conflict, in late April this year between Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan. If you look at the map, it's in the Batken region where you have enclaves. It's a very, very complicated, entangled, tricky part of the region. And So we actually, at IFEAC, devoted a webinar, I'm sorry, it's in French, but it's available on our YouTube channel, about this. So there are some small conflicts, and even if they are not armed conflicts with people who tragically die, be they army or civilians, soldiers or civilians, there are also patterns of using the border and border trade and all these border points as leverage. So sometimes even in the framework of the Eurasian Economic Union, which is supposed to be a free trade agreement, the lifting of borders and so on, the free movement of goods, actually at the border between Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. I notice it because I'm living in Bishkek, and it's like 50 kilometers from the city, the border. I can see it. Sometimes it's closed where it's not supposed to be, because it's like a no border agreement, free trade regime, and so on. So it's very complicated. There are some conflict patterns, but so much less than what was predicted in the early 90s. Water management is, of course, a major issue in this respect, corruption from those people who work in border management. But basically, yes, this is the picture.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I think we have another question from Bishkek about China. I was waiting for this question. Is China, as a regional superpower, trying to influence the politics of this region, Central Asian countries, and how are the relations between the state and China? And I will ask also about local natural resources, communication routes, and security issues. What is the role of China in this region?
Yeah, you first or me?
As you wish.
That is not an answer. No, I can go first if you want.
Okay, yeah, sure.
Like the best chapter for this, the two best chapters of this would be Catherine Pujol's chapters on the foreign policies of Central Asia, Central Asian countries, and also the chapter by Sebastian Perus on the Silk Road, so the Belt and Road Initiative by the People's Republic of China. China's regional superpower, is it trying to influence? Of course. Of course, but they do so in a typical Chinese way. They don't bluntly come in and demand this or that. They are very known of not having a military presence in other countries, unless their infrastructure demands it. Like, for instance, in Sudan, they send a peacekeeping mission in order to protect their oil interests there and so on. But mostly China stays at economic level. But since they have so much money and they have so much expertise in building infrastructure, they kind of lure different countries into their sphere of influence by investing in them. And then these countries are not really able to pay them back. The regime leaders, they benefit very well from these investment schemes, but it's the taxpayer that will have to pay them back, and they won't, and the interest will grow. And this is how these countries stay tied to China due to their debt. On the other hand, there is a whole idea to use this infrastructure schemes and increase infrastructure as a way to increase trade. And this is where China, of course, even if the Silk and Road scheme is not going to replace the maritime dimension of getting resources to a research-hungry China, 90% of all world trade happens through sea lanes. But still, they are increasing the share of overland trade and also getting resources directly into China. We have several pipelines from gas and oil that have been funded by China that directly go from Central Asia, from the oil fields and the gas fields throughout the region directly into China, mostly to Hormuz, the dry port. They have created new railroads as part of the intercontinental trade that is supposed to connect China directly to markets in Europe and throughout Eurasia, but also Western Europe, where more money is. And these are going through Central Asia. The idea to what extent Central Asians, everyday Central Asians, will actually benefit from this, from trains passing through their territory, not so much. But they are, of course, already in the orbit of the retail cheap Chinese goods that enter the markets and actually also make a life a lot better for people, for a very impoverished population, that they can actually buy more goods based on the cheaper Chinese prices than what was previously available. So not everything is also bad here. But yes, they are really trying to influence, but China also has to be a little bit careful. This area traditionally has been part of the Russian, first Tsarist, then Soviet, and now after the ascent of Putin, so say 2001, the Russian sphere of influence. And Russia does have security alliances with these countries. So where China is trying to make up for its position by increasing economic ties that Russia cannot meet, Russia is still trying to counter that with security ties and cultural ties, because most Central Asians will also be fluent in Russian. Media connections with Russia and also migration to Russia is very large. These are different ties that Russia has. So they all have their own linkages. And so far, we see that in the beginning, they were quite complementary, the Chinese influence and the Russian influence. And they're also major players. We have Turkey, a little bit of India, Pakistan, Korea, Japan. So there are other players also in the European Union and also in the US, also in the region, of course, but definitely China, Russia are the main ones. In the beginning, this was still amicable and gentleman-wise, but we see also some increased competition since 2006 in the creation of the Shanghai Cooperation Agreement organization, in which China definitely plays first violin, and they included Russia. And now Russia also tried to counter that with the Eurasian Economic Union and try to counter. And Russia is less, is more forcible in this, does a lot of backdoor arm wrestling in order to force Central Asian elites to join its international regional organization. China is more on a bilateral basis, except for the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And this way also gives the illusion of more freedom. But once countries are tied up economically with China, China will be able to influence, although it be it softly, the policies and the economic preferences of these countries in the future. Adrien?
Yes. What can I add? No doubt, China in political, economic terms, security also, is very much invested in the region, like it does in other parts of the world, but this is like a neighboring region for the PRC at its occidental western border directly. So there are many projects in connection with the BRI. There is financial investment, there are infrastructures, roads which are built with the help of Chinese money, Chinese workers, Chinese engineers in Tajikistan, in Kyrgyzstan, in Turkmenistan. There's a railroad, a huge project connecting various regions and so on. This is a major investment in the banking sector. There are also on the cultural level, Confucius Institutes and so on. This is real. So many goods now go through the Horgos dry port, which is at the Kazakhstan-China border in southeastern Kazakhstan. So there is a major investment. And as I told you earlier, China is holding 35% and 42% respectively of Kyrgyzstan's and Tajikistan's financial debt. 42, this is enormous for Tajikistan. When you go to Dushanbe, you see that there are major projects of modernizing or changing the urban landscapes and building or even new official buildings for ministries, organizations, and so on. Can you imagine? This is built by a neighboring now world power. And also there is a military base in the Pamir, in the Gornobadakhshan, eastern Tajikistan, which is very, which is the object of kind of controversies or discussions between specialists, because it's not official. No one really knows what documents in open sources prove, certify that the base is existing, but so many specialists are saying, yes, there is a Chinese base on Tajikistani soil, even if there is another major Russian military base also on Tajikistani soil. This is one of the reasons why, this is so strategic as a country in this regard. And I would like to remind the public that probably you are aware that the only official military base of the PRC outside of the country's border is in Djibouti. And I think this might be then the second Chinese military base, but it's not so official. So yes, it's very much investing. And in the framework of force of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, also, you know that Pakistan and India joined CSO recently, and there are talks about I think Iran joining in, because they officially are now considered as not observer country, but candidates to joining. So yes, this is real. This is real.
Do you have any questions or comments? No, maybe the last one. The last question about the situation during the pandemic of COVID-19 in the country of this region. How about the healthcare systems, or maybe if there was any change, power change during this pandemic?
Okay, I'm going to leave this one to Adrien, because he was in the region during COVID times. So, he's in the best position to answer this one.
First of all, COVID arrived quite slowly in the spring 2020, compared to other world regions. So this is one point. This is mostly because these countries are not so overpopulated. And the most populated country, Uzbekistan, has less direct, airline links, aviation links with these parts of China where it started, like Wuhan and that kind of regions. And cross-border trade is not, a major vector of disseminating the pandemic, because I think was mostly airlines, which first started to spread. So this is one point. Second point, some countries like Kazakhstan closed their borders very quickly, in March, like a strong move, like announcing in February that they won't host any for instance, student or exchange professors from Europe, especially from Italy, France, and so on, in February, like in March 2020. Then the lockdown was quite early, March, April. The virus didn't spread at the time. So when they opened again, then there was a major wave in most of these countries in June, July, because actually they locked down and then opened again and the virus spread. Major waves, healthcare systems unprepared, poorly furnished, and so on. So this is really was a blast. But as populations are quite young, as I told earlier, not so overpopulated cities and so on, despite the poor conditions of the healthcare system and hospitals and so on, it was a blow, but not comparable to these countries such as the US and Brazil and India, and Iran, which suffered a lot at the beginning of the pandemic. Then there is one very specific feature. Turkmenistan sometimes is very different from the others. I told about its neutrality in terms of foreign policy. Well, Turkmenistan is the only country, I think, in the world which did not transfer data about how many people were sick or died to WHO, World Health Organization. If you look at the figures today, I think still Turkmenistan supposedly had zero case officially, even if now they are, vaccines to the population. So this is very complicated. Still, it's a closed country. Kazakhstan is also closed for many foreigners and so on, whereas Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan resumed. They got back to the no visa regime for many countries, so you can easily get there. Tajikistan has always been complicated. So if you want to go there, if you are not afraid because of the pandemic, you are vaccinated and so on, you can easily go with a great number of passports to Kyrgyzstan and Uzbekistan today, no problem. Now about vaccines. Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan are embottling Sputnik vaccines on their soil. They also have facilities to produce, I think, Sinopharm or Sinovac, I'm sorry, I'm not sure, kind of vaccine on their territory in factories. And they receive various shipments of vaccines from Russia, China, and now AstraZeneca and so on. But in these countries, if you compare with Europe, there is a maximum of 20% of the population which is, who is fully vaccinated. So it's going to be very slow, very slow. And today people live there as COVID was ancient history. Like they really don't care, they don't pay attention because everyone was sick one, if not two or three times already. So there is this idea that, well, still, you know, you are protected because you have immunity, which actually, you know, disappears after 6 months. So this is the situation, basically.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we will stop here. Thank you very much, Adrien Fauve and Jörg van den Bosch for the participation. Thank you, audience. And we invite you to our next seminar, 2nd of November. Professor Elżbieta Hałas, Nikola Maszkowski, Professor Luba Jurgenson and Dennis Smith will present their book, Politics of Symbolization Across Central and Eastern Europe. So thank you very much and have a good evening.
Yes, thank you very much for having us. This was a real honor to be able to talk for you guys. And yeah, I think, Adrien, we have a good vibe after so many years of cooperation. So when it comes to tackling questions, I feel very comfortable doing that with you.
Absolutely. We are a great team. Thank you so much, Dr. Torbitska, and to your center. And looking forward to further cooperation. Please, to the students, keep on doing your research. And let's hope COVID-19 will be ancient history for real.
Exactly, exactly.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye. Thank you very much for your attention. I enjoyed this very much.
Thanks, Professor. Mm-hmm.